identical words in English and in French, and we'll concentrate this video on the words in English that will end with I-B-L-E, because actually they will be written almost the same way. I mean, in most of the cases, they will be written the same way, but not in all the cases, of course. And the meaning will be the same, all right? But then the first thing that you've got to keep in mind is that the word must exist in French, because all the words ending with I-B-L-E in English, well, they don't exist in French, okay? And then the second thing, as I said, in some cases, few exceptions or modifications when it comes to writing and, of course, pronunciation. Okay, so we'll see that together and we'll start right now. Accessible. Admissible. Audible. Bible. Combustible. Comestible. Compatible. Compréhensible. Conductible. Constructible. Convertible. Corruptible. Crédible. Divisible. Éligible. Extensible. Flexible. Fusible. Horrible. Impassible. Implausible. Impossible. Inaccessible. Inadmissible. Inaudible. It waits away. Incombustible. Incompatible. Incompréhensible. Inconvertible. Incorrigible. Incorruptible. Indestructible. Indivisible. Inéligible. Inflexible. Intelligible. Invincible. Invisible. Irrésistible. Passible. Possible. Reconstructible. Répréhensible. Réversible. Risible. Sensible. Terrible. Transmissible. Visible. Identical words in English and in French, and especially the words that will end with A-B-L-E. Okay, so if we're talking about the words ending with A-B-L-E, you've got to remember that first it must exist in French. If it exists in French, then the meaning will be the same. Okay, and the second thing you should think about is that in some cases we will have, when it comes to the writing of the word, few exceptions or modifications possible. Okay, so let's start now. Abominable. Absorbable. Acceptable. Adaptable. Administrable. Admirable. Adoptable. Adorable. Applicable. Appréciable. Arbitrable. Assimilable. Attachable. Biodégradable. Blâmable. Câble. calculable, capable, cartable, censurable, certifiable, changeable, chargeable, classifiable, confortable, commandable, comparable, confessable, confirmable, contestable, cultivable, défendable, déformable, dégradable, déplorable, détachable, détectable, durable, estimable, évitable, évitable, excusable, fable, favorable, filmable, fixable, formable, formidable, friable, groupable, habitable, héritable, honorable, identifiable, imitable, impalpable, implacable, importable, improbable, incapable, inclinable, incommunicable, incomparable, incontestable, indispensable, inflammable, inhabitable, inimitable, inséparable, instable, interminable, intolérable, invariable, invulnérable, lamentable, limitable, manipulable, mémorable, mimable, misérable, notable, palpable, payable, portable, qualifiable, quantifiable, recyclable, rentable, représentable, sociable, solvable, sortable, stable, table, tenable, tolérable, transportable, transposable, véritable. La place de l'adverbe. And we will focus on this video when we've got what we call une forme composée de verbe. So if you're thinking about, for instance, passé composé, all these composed tenses where you've got two parts, remember, first you've got avoir or être, and then the second part is le participe passé. Okay, so we'll see where we should put the adverb, l'adverbe, when we've got this type of structure. Okay, so we'll see only one sentence and we'll see the different possibilities we've got. So where to put this adverb, okay? So the first one, here, we've got il a attendu patiemment le train, okay? So here we've got the verb attendre. Attendre is to wait, and this is the passé composé form, if you remember. So first you've got avoir at the present tense, and then this form is what we call participe passé, okay? So il a attendu. And then, I mean, that's the rule. Normally, the adverb, l'adverbe, should come after the verb. Okay, so you put it right here. Patiemment, patiently. Okay, and then le train, the train. Il a attendu patiemment le train. All right? So that's, I mean, the first option you could have if you want to construct this type of structure in which you will have this adverb. Okay, and then if you've got this structure, like here, when you've got a composed tense, so two parts. Okay, but then the same sentence, and it's also possible, il a, okay, so first you will put avoir, so you don't change the structure of the sentence, but then it's possible to put your adverb right here after avoir. Il a patiemment. And then you continue. Here your participe passé. Attendu le train. Okay. So the first one, il a attendu patiemment le train. And then the second one, il a patiemment attendu le train. All right. And then we've got a third option. So it would be also possible to put it like that. Il a attendu le train. And then you put your adverb at the end here. Patiemment. Okay. Oops, sorry, there is a space here and it shouldn't be here. So, il a attendu le train patiemment. Okay, so let's see again the three options we've got. The first one, il a attendu patiemment le train. Second one, il a patiemment attendu le train. And the last one, il a attendu le train patiemment. Les locutions adverbiales. And we'll focus this video on les locutions adverbiales, when they will replace or when they will be associated with an adverb that will end with ment, M-E-N-T. Okay, so let's see now an example. So, of course, when we're talking about adverbs, like here, we're talking about, well, this word that you can add to the verb to give more information, like il parle gentiment. Okay, you've got here the verb parler. Parler is to speak or to talk. And then gentiment, nicely. Okay, donc il parle gentiment. So that's the first option. I mean, you can add this adverb after your verb just to give more information. Okay, or then it would be possible also to use what we call locution adverbiale. Okay, to, well, clearly get exactly the same meaning. But in that case here, you will use, well, une locution, so a group of words, okay? And then these words are not adverbs, but then they will have the same function and the result will be the same. Il parle avec, so avec, with, and then gentillesse, kindness, avec gentillesse. Il parle avec gentillesse. So this avec gentillesse, this is exactly what we call locution adverbiale. Okay, so we'll see a few examples now, and the first one will be prudemment, prudemment, okay, so you get the translation here, prudemment, okay, and then you could use une locution adverbiale avec prudence, okay, so you can use prudemment, or then you can use avec prudence, all right, patiemment, patiemment, get a translation here, or then you could use avec patience, okay? Patiemment, avec patience. Calmement, calmement, or then avec calme, okay? So whether calmement, or then avec calme. Péniblement, péniblement, translation here, or then you could use avec peine, all right? So, whether péniblement or la locution adverbiale, sorry, avec peine. Merveilleusement, it's a long one, merveilleusement, merveilleusement, okay, you get the translation here, or then you could use à merveille. All right, so whether merveilleusement or à merveille. Effectivement, effectivement, or then en effet, okay, so effectivement, en effet. Généralement, 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 or then, en général. Généralement, or en général. Particulièrement, 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 or en particulier. En particulier. Particulièrement, en particulier. partiellement, partiellement, or then, en partie, ok, partiellement, en partie, silencieusement, 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 or then you could use, en silence, silencieusement, en silence, progressivement, 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 or then you could use, whether petit à petit, or peu à peu. Ok, so, progressivement, or petit à petit, ou peu à peu. Les locutions adverbiales. So, when we talk about les locutions adverbiales, we will talk about group of words that will together, when you put them together, you can use them instead of an adverb. Okay, so it can be quite useful. And we'll see a list of locutions adverbiales in this video. Okay, so the first one would be à juste titre. À juste titre. Okay, and you'll find below the translation in English. À juste titre. À tort. À tort, à tort, à volonté, à volonté, oops, sorry, à l'écart, à l'écart, à l'écart. À l'endroit, à l'endroit, à l'endroit. And then, à l'envers, à l'envers, à l'envers. À l'unanimité, à l'unanimité. It's a tricky one, this one. Unanimité. À l'unanimité, à l'unanimité. Du coup, du coup, du coup, du coup. En fait. So whether you pronounce the final T or not, you can hear both. En fait, en fait, en fait. I'd rather pronounce it personally. En fait. En réalité. En réalité. En réalité. En vrac. En vrac. En vrac. Par cœur. Par cœur. Par cœur. Les antonymes, okay, or then we can use as well les contraires, and we'll see only les antonymes or les contraires that will be constructed with les préfixes D or DE accent aigu S, okay? So, but then, well, then the first thing that maybe we should define or clear out is what an antonyme or un contraire is, and well, in English it's almost the same, okay, or then contraire, it's opposite, okay? So we'll see these antonymes or contraires constructed with D or DE accent aigu S, and we'll first start with the DE accent aigu. And so, the first one, favorable, okay, so I will put all the time in green here, the translation in English, favorable, and it will give us défavorable. All right, so favorable, défavorable. Favoriser, favoriser. Same technique, you just put this D. Défavoriser, okay? Favoriser, défavoriser. Pénaliser, pénaliser. We'll give us dépénaliser. Okay, so pénaliser, dépénaliser. And then, obviously, the substantive as well, pénalisation. Pénalisation will give us dépénalisation. Okay, pénalisation, and then just dépénalisation. And now we'll see the other group, so DE accent aigu S, okay, so you've got to keep in mind that, of course, we will put this S because, well, the words will start with whether a vowel or the sound of a vowel. That's normally the reason why we put this S like that when we're talking about this prefix, okay? So, first one, agréable, agréable, and then it will give us désagréable, okay? Agréable, and then désagréable. Espérer, so it's the verb here, espérer, and then it will give us désespérer, désespérer, okay? So, espérer, and then désespérer. Substantive, espoir, espoir. Exactly the same way of constructing or constructing the thing. So, désespoir. Espoir, désespoir. Obéir, okay, the verb, obéir. And then we'll get désobéir. All right, so obéir and désobéir. Obéissance. Obéissance will give us désobéissance, désobéissance. Okay, so obéissance and then désobéissance. Organiser, it's the verb, organiser, and it will give us désorganiser, désorganiser. Okay, so organiser and then désorganiser. And then naturally, organisation, organisation will give us désorganisation, okay? Désorganisation, organisation, désorganisation. Les antonymes, or then it's also possible to call them les contraires, okay? And we'll see especially les antonymes au contraire that will start with a prefix mal or mais. Okay, so first thing that we should see together is what is an antonym or un contraire. Well, in English, it would be translated by antonym or opposite. Okay, and so we'll see in this lesson first the antonym that will start with mal, and then after that we'll see the ones that will start with mais. Okay, so let's concentrate first on the mal. And so first example, quite interesting, and it's heureux here, okay? So you can see the translation in English here in green. Heureux, okay? And so if you want to make the opposite, le contraire, l'antonyme, then you just put this mal and then heureux, malheureux. All right? So heureux will give you malheureux. All right? Second example. Honnête, honnête. And then exactly the same rule, so malhonnête, malhonnête. So honnête, malhonnête. Habile, habile will give you malhabile, malhabile. Okay, so habile, and then you just put this mal, malhabile. Adroit, adroit will give you maladroit. Okay, so quite simple, adroit, and then maladroit. So now let's see the one that will start with mais, okay? And the first one is content, okay? So I did put the feminine form here, like that. So content, masculine form. Of course, if you put the feminine form, then you will have to add this E, and then phonetically it will be a bit different. It will be contente. Okay, so masculin, content. Féminin, contente. All right, and then if you want to put the opposite or construct the opposite, so you will get this mais, mécontent, and then the feminine form, mécontente. Okay, so content, mécontent, and then the feminine, contente, mécontente. All right. Connu, so exactly the same thing. I did put the feminine form here, but then phonetically it doesn't exist. You don't pronounce it, so it will be the same form phonetically for the masculine form and the feminine form. Connu. Okay, so connu, and then it will give you méconnu. Okay, connu, méconnu. Le verbe faire. Le verbe faire is used quite much in French language, and then I thought it might be useful to make a little lesson regarding the verb faire and the different uses we've got for this verb. And of course, so I can show you the example, we'll have the translation. Okay, so faire here, and then we've got an example here, faire un gâteau. Un gâteau, it's a cake, okay? And in that case, of course, if you want to translate that, well, you could use this to make, okay? And then faire un dessin, a drawing, faire un dessin, in that case, that's, it would be translated with to do, okay? So these are, of course, the two first translations that normally we tend to use when we translate the verb faire, okay? But then we'll see that we've got other uses of faire. For instance, faire du piano, okay? And in that case, well, clearly, you would translate it with to play, okay? Faire du piano. Then it could be as well faire du foot, du football, so basket, whatever. So we're talking here about, sport activity. And in that case, it will be also to play. Okay? Faire les magasins. Okay, magasin, we're talking about boutique, so shops. And in that case, it would be to go shopping. Okay, so faire un gâteau, faire un dessin, faire du piano, faire du foot. Faire les magasins, okay? Let's see some other uses. Here, faire le mort, okay? To play dead. Faire le mort, so it could be faire le fou, faire something. So actually, you pretend to be something that you're not, okay? So in that case, faire le mort, to play dead. Faire 10 euros. It's quite interesting because we tend to use that quite often as well when you're talking about the price, so the how much it will cost. Okay, so ça fait 10 euros. Okay, in that case, translation would be to cost. It's also possible to use this faire when you're talking about the weight. So faire 300 grammes. Or then it's also possible if you're want to talk about your size. So in that case, when you say faire 1m80, of course, you're talking about your size, so to be tall. And then faire du diabète. So you can see that it's also possible to use it when we're talking about medical things. And then so it would be, in that case, to have, of course. Ne rien faire, and especially this sentence, it's it's quite common to use this, ça ne fait rien, okay, and the translation would be, it doesn't matter, okay, so ça ne fait rien, ça ne fait rien. Other little modification, ça ne me fait rien, okay, so ça ne me fait rien, in that case it's for me, and well, translation would be, I don't mind. Okay, so ça ne fait rien, it doesn't matter, but then ça ne me fait rien, I don't mind. Okay, then faire quelque chose, in that case it would be to act, all right. Faire jeune, so when you use this expression, il fait jeune, you're talking about the appearance, so it would be to look, okay, to look young, faire jeune. Faire bien, ça fait bien. And the translation would be to look as well, so it looks good. Okay, the last page, but not the least interesting. So il fait chaud, so you can see that we tend to use this faire when we're talking about, well, the weather or the temperature. So in that case, it's hot. And then il fait froid, so obviously it's cold. And we've got this expression that we tend to use quite often, il fait beau, okay? And then the translation will be, it's a nice weather or it's a lovely day, il fait beau, okay? You can put that, of course, at the negative form as well. Or then, ça fait trois ans que. And in that case, the translation will be, it's been 3 years since, okay? Ça fait trois ans que. Then we can take another example, and it would be a slightly different. Ça fait deux ans que j'apprends le français. So the translation would be, I have been learning French for 2 years. Les locutions adverbiales qui expriment le temps. Okay, so first thing, of course, is what are we talking about when we're talking about une locution adverbiale, okay? Well, actually, it's quite simple because if we're talking about une locution adverbiale, so we'll talk about a group of words that will together replace an adverb, okay? So it's an option that you will have to complete a verb, because that's the first function of what we call an adverb, okay? But then you don't have to use this adverb if it exists or if it doesn't exist, and still in that case you will use this locution adverbiale, so group of words that will be used instead of an adverb, okay, so to complete a verb. So we'll see them right now. À l'instant, okay, and then for each locution adverbiale I will give you the translation in English right here, okay? So à l'instant, à la longue, à la longue, à présent, à l'avenir, avec le temps. Avec le temps, avec le temps, pour l'instant, pour l'instant, en ce moment, pour le moment. Pour le moment, pour le moment. De bonne heure, de bonne heure, de bonne heure. Tôt, tôt, tôt. Tard. Tard, tard, d'un moment à l'autre, d'un moment à l'autre, d'un moment à l'autre, en avance, en avance, à l'heure, à l'heure, à l'heure. En retard, en retard, en retard. Sur le champ, sur le champ, sur le champ. Tout de suite. Tout de suite, tout de suite. Or then it's also possible to pronounce it like tout de suite, tout de suite. Tout à l'heure, tout à l'heure, tout à l'heure. Pour les locutions adverbiales, and then qui exprime la rapidité. And of course, the first thing that we've got to understand is what is une locution adverbiale. And well, the answer is quite simple. When we're talking about une locution adverbiale, we're talking about a group of words that all together will be used instead of what we call an adverb. Okay, so remember, when we're talking about an adverb, it's this type of words that we will use normally to complete a verb, so to give more information with a verb, and then in that case, in most of the cases, we tend to use an adverb, but then it's also possible to use group of words that will all together have the same use and the same function of like an adverb. Okay, so we'll see them together right now. The first one, à toute vitesse. Okay, and you will see here the translation in English. Okay, à toute vitesse. À toute vitesse. À toute vitesse. À toute allure. À toute allure. À toute allure. En un clin d'œil. En un clin d'œil. En un clin d'œil. En un rien de temps. En un rien de temps. En un rien de temps. En toute hâte. En toute hâte. En toute hâte. Les locutions adverbiales qui expriment la situation géographique. Okay, but then the first thing that we've got to see is, of course, what are we talking when we are talking about une locution adverbiale? And actually, it's quite simple because une locution adverbiale, well, it's a group of words that all together will be used as an adverb, okay? So that's exactly what we will use une locution adverbiale for, okay? So it's just a complete verb, all right? And then you're using it instead of an adverb just because, well, you want to use something else if the adverb is existing, or then in some cases, well, adverbs are not existing to express what la locution adverbiale will express, okay? So we'll see. Now, the first one. Au-dessus. Au-dessus. Okay, so each time you will see the translation in English below. Au-dessus. Au-dessous. 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 En dessous. En dessous, en dessous. En face, en face, en face. Par-dessus, par-dessus, par-dessus. Par-dessous, par-dessous, par-dessous. Sans dessus-dessous, sans dessus-dessous, sans dessus-dessous. Le repas. Okay, so let's start now. Un potage. Un potage, un potage. Une soupe, une soupe, une soupe. Un bouillon, un bouillon, un bouillon. Un rôti. Un rôti, Un rôti. Un ragoût. Un ragoût. Un ragoût. Un soufflet. Un soufflet. Un soufflet. Une quiche. Une quiche. Une quiche. Un shish kebab. Or un kebab. Un kebab. Un kebab. Or then, un shish kebab. Un shish kebab. Une boulette de viande. Une boulette de viande. Une boulette de viande. Une omelette. Une omelette. Une omelette. Un sauté. Un sauté. Un sauté. Une salade verte. Une salade verte. Une salade verte. Une salade composée. Une salade composée. Une salade composée. Des pâtes. Des pâtes. Des pâtes. Du riz. Du riz. Du riz. Une vinaigrette. Une vinaigrette. Une vinaigrette. Une entrée. Une entrée. Une entrée. Un plat principal. Un plat principal. Un plat principal. Un accompagnement. Un accompagnement. Un accompagnement. Un fromage. Un fromage. Un fromage. Un dessert. Un dessert. Un dessert. Les produits laitiers. Okay, we've got a translation here in English. So, les produits laitiers. Let's start right now. Un lait entier. Un lait entier. Un lait entier. Un lait demi-écrémé. Un lait demi-écrémé. Un lait demi-écrémé. Un lait écrémé. Un lait écrémé. Un lait écrémé. Un beurre. Un beurre. Un beurre. Une margarine. Une margarine. Sorry. Une margarine. Well, this one was not too difficult anyway. Une crème. Une crème. Une crème. Une crème allégée. Une crème allégée. Une crème allégée. Une crème épaisse. Une crème épaisse. Une crème épaisse. Une crème fouettée. Une crème fouettée, une crème fouettée. Une crème fraîche. Une crème fraîche, une crème fraîche. Un yaourt. Oups, un yaourt, un yaourt. Une glace. Une glace, une glace. Un fromage. Un fromage, un fromage. Un fromage à pâte molle. Un fromage à pâte molle. Un fromage à pâte molle. Oups. My God. Un fromage à pâte semi-molle. Un fromage à pâte semi-molle. Un fromage à pâte semi-molle. Un fromage à pâte pressée non cuite. Un fromage à pâte pressée non cuite. Un fromage à pâte pressée non cuite. Un fromage à pâte pressée cuite. Un fromage à pâte pressée cuite. Un fromage à pâte pressée cuite. Un fromage à la crème. Un fromage à la crème. Un fromage à la crème. Un fromage frais. Un fromage frais. Un fromage frais. Un fromage râpé. Un fromage râpé. Un fromage râpé. Les œufs. So it will be a short one, but I think it's quite useful in some cases to only focus on the little thing, okay? So after that, everything is clear. The first one that we'll see is un œuf. Un œuf, un œuf. And the tricky thing when we're talking about eggs is that if you listen carefully, the pronunciation is changing quite much, because for the singular form it's œuf, but then for the plural form here it's œufs, okay? Des œufs. Des œufs. Des œufs. Un œuf de poule. Un œuf de poule. Un œuf de poule. Un œuf de canne. Un œuf de canne. Un œuf de canne. Un œuf de caille. Un œuf de caille. Un œuf de caille. Un œuf d'oie. Un œuf d'oie. Un œuf d'oie. Une coquille. Une coquille. Une coquille. Le blanc d'œuf. Le blanc d'œuf. Le blanc d'œuf. Le jaune d'œuf. Le jaune d'œuf. Le jaune d'œuf. Les herbes. OK, so let's start now. Le fenouil. Le fenouil. Le fenouil. La feuille de laurier. La feuille de laurier. La feuille de laurier. Le persil. In some cases, you can hear persil. Okay, but normally it should be le persil. Le persil. Le persil. La ciboulette. La ciboulette. La ciboulette. La menthe. La menthe. La menthe. Le thym. Le thym. Le thym. La sauge. La sauge. La sauge. L'estragon. L'estragon. La marjolaine. La marjolaine. La marjolaine. Le basilic. Le basilic. Le basilic. L'origan. L'origan. La coriandre. La coriandre. La coriandre. L'aneth. L'aneth. Le romarin. Le romarin. Le romarin. Les haricots et les pois. Okay, so you get the translation in English right here. Let's start now. Un haricot vert. Un haricot vert. Un haricot vert. Un haricot grimpant. Un haricot grimpant. Sorry. Un haricot grimpant. Une fève. Une fève. Une fève. Un gros haricot blanc. Un gros haricot blanc. Un gros haricot blanc. Un haricot blanc. Un haricot blanc. Un haricot blanc. Un haricot rouge. Un haricot rouge. Un haricot rouge. Une graine de soja. Une graine de soja. Une graine de soja. Un haricot à œil noir. Un haricot à œil noir. Un haricot à œil noir. Un flageolet. Un flageolet. Un flageolet. Une lentille. Une lentille. Une lentille. Une lentille rouge. Une lentille rouge. Une lentille rouge. Un pois chiche. Un pois chiche. Un pois chiche. Un pois cassé. Un pois cassé. Un pois cassé. Les poissons. So quite useful one. Une lotte. Une lotte. Une lotte. Un maquereau. Un maquereau. Un maquereau. Un espadon. Un espadon. Un espadon. Une sole. Une sole. Une sole. Une limande sole. Une limande sole. Une limande sole. Un aigle fin. Un aigle fin. Un aigle fin. Une sardine. Une sardine. Une sardine. Une raie. Une raie. Une raie. Un merlan. Un merlan. Un merlan. Un bar. Un bar. Un bar. Un saumon. Un saumon. Un saumon. Une morue. Une morue. Une morue. Une dorade. Une dorade. Une dorade. Un thon. Un thon. Un thon. Un rouget barbet. Un rouget barbet. Un rouget barbet. Un flétan. Un flétan. Un flétan. Une truite arc-en-ciel. Une truite arc-en-ciel. Une truite arc-en-ciel. Faire à manger. And we'll concentrate on les adjectifs. Okay? So let's see now. Griller. Griller. Mariner. Mariner. Macérer. Macérer. En sauce. En sauce. Farci. Farci. En purée. En purée. Cuit. Cuit. Bouilli. Bouilli. Poché. Poché. Sauter. Sauter. Frit. Frit. Cuit à la vapeur. Cuit à la vapeur. Fumer. Fumer. sécher. Sécher. Pluriel des noms composés. Because it's actually quite tricky for persons who are learning French, and even for French people, in some cases it can be quite tricky to put, when we call this nom composé, of course we call about a noun, but it's composed, so normally you get two parts. And when you want to put this noun at the plural form, then it can be a bit tricky. This video will only focus on the nouns that are formed by two nouns, okay? So we're not talking about adjectives or verbs or preposition, because it's possible. In that case, we're only concentrating on these nouns composed by two nouns, okay? And, well, the thing is that, as always in French, it's never 100%, because that's the way it works. But then the good news is that it's 90%, and it's quite much, in 90% of the cases, the two nouns will actually be at the plural form. Okay, so if you want to put this noun at the plural form, you will have to put the two nouns that compose this composed noun at the plural. Okay, I hope I'm clear. So I've been preparing few examples, okay? And here you've got the, well, singular form, le singulier. And the first one, un homme grenouille, okay? So I will put here that translation in English, okay? Un homme grenouille. And so, well, as I said, if you want to put this noun at the plural form, then you will get des hommes here, so the S, mark of the plural, and then here as well, mark of the plural, grenouille. Okay, so un homme grenouille, des hommes grenouilles. Un homme orchestre, and so you get the translation here. Same thing, des hommes orchestre. Okay, so you get the plural here, and then the plural here. Okay. Un homme sandwich, and then you will get des hommes sandwich, like that as well. Une infirmière chef will give you des infirmières chef. Okay, and then you can notice that, well, as we saw previously, this final S is not pronounced, so clearly if you only think about, I mean, the phonetical aspect of the thing, une infirmière chef, des infirmières chef. The only difference will be here in the liaison, because actually you don't pronounce this final S here or here. Okay, so une infirmière chef, des infirmières chef. Un aide comptable, des aides comptables. Okay, same thing, you put this S and S here, but then you don't pronounce them. Un aide cuisinier, des aides cuisiniers. Okay, S and S. Un aide infirmier, des aides infirmiers. Un avion cargo, des avions cargo. Same thing, S, S, but then we don't pronounce them. Un avocat conseil, des avocats conseil. S, S, but then we don't pronounce it, or them. Un café concert, des cafés concerts. Un café-théâtre, des cafés-théâtres. Le pluriel des noms composés, okay, so if you didn't watch the first part, well, I would advise you to do it, okay, so it's, maybe it would be more clear. Okay, if you did, then let's start. And then keep in mind that this video, in this video, will work, or we'll see the words that will be composed by a noun and an adjective. Okay, so in the previous lesson we saw, well, these nouns, when they were composed by two nouns, okay, but in that case it will be noun and adjective. Okay, and then, well, it will be exactly the same thing. It's never 100% in French, so it will be 90%. So in 90% of the cases, you will have to put well, the noun and the adjective at the plural form if you want to, well, put this all noun, so this composed noun, at the plural form. Okay, so we'll see how it works. And then we'll have first the singular form here. So here is the first one, un haut commissionnaire. Okay, un haut commissionnaire. And if we want to put this word at the plural form, then it will be quite simple, because you just need to here and here add the plural form. So in that case, it's S and S. Okay, des hauts commissionnaires. And if you're a bit careful, you can hear that un haut commissionnaire and des hauts commissionnaires, well, clearly it is pronounced the same way. So you put the S at the end of both things here, okay, but then you don't pronounce them, so it will be phonetically almost the same, okay, in most of the cases. Un haut relief. Okay, un haut relief. And if we want to put the plural form, then it's quite simple, because S and S, but then we don't pronounce them here. Des hauts reliefs. Okay, un haut relief, des hauts reliefs. Un franc-maçon. Okay, un franc-maçon. And then plural form, exactly the same rule. S here and S here. Des francs-maçons. And then you don't pronounce them. Des francs-maçons. Un franc-tireur. Un franc-tireur. And then plural form, exactly the same rule. Des francs-tireurs. Un courbouillon. Un courbouillon. And then, if you want to put the plural form, well, same rule. S, S. You don't pronounce it, des courbouillons. Un courbouillon, des courbouillons. Un court-circuit, un court-circuit. Same thing, des courts-circuits, des courts-circuits. Un beau-père, un beau-père. So here it's interesting, because if you remember, we saw that previously, this beau, so the adjective beau, you've got the singular form here, and you've got the plural here. You don't put S at the end for the plural, but you will put this X, okay? So X à la fin de beau, okay? But then it's exactly the same thing, because you don't pronounce it. Des beaux-pères, okay? Remember the S, but then it's silent. Des beaux-pères. Un beau-père, des beaux-pères. Une belle-mère, des belles-mères. Same rule here, S and S, but you don't pronounce it. Une belle-sœur, des belles-sœurs. Okay? Une belle-sœur, des belles-sœurs. That's le pluriel des noms composés. And we'll take the time in this video to see something quite tricky. And I'm really sorry about that. But, well, I need to do my job and to explain or to tell you how it goes. When you get this composed noun, and when this composed noun is composed by first a noun, or not first, but then a noun and the adjective grand, because in most of the cases this grand will be in the first place, okay, it will be tricky. It will be tricky, let's be honest. The thing is that we will need to divide this video and to see how it works for the masculine form and then the feminine form. Just because when we'll see the masculine form, it's actually quite easy. It is not difficult at all, because when we've got this example, like un grand-père, okay, so of course you get first this grand, and then after that you get the père. If you want to put this word at the plural form, then you will get des grands-pères. And it's actually quite simple, because it will respect the rule, I mean the thing that we saw previously. You just need to put S at the end of each words, okay, so grand with S and then père with S, like that, Okay, so it's not really difficult, and especially if you think about that, you don't pronounce this S, so actually phonetically it's the same grand-père here and grand-père here. Okay, so let's be honest, I mean, if it's for the masculine form, then it's not difficult. But if it's for the feminine form, and that's where it is a bit strange, but I mean, that's just a language, so we need to see how it goes. If you have at the singular form, for the feminine, this form here, so grand, instead of grande, because normally it's an adjective, and normally we should have a here, okay? But it does, I mean, it does happen that in some cases, like with this word, in grand-mère, then actually you don't have this a at the end of the adjective. So if you have this form, so first the adjective grand, at the feminine, but not really at the feminine because you don't have this a, okay? Then that's when it will be tricky because you will have, well, two options to put the plural form. The first one will be this one. So you just put this S and S at the end of the first and the second part, okay? And it's also possible to see it like that. So only S at the end of the second word or the second part of this composed word, okay? So, des grand-mères. As I said, phonetically, it's the same anyway, because it will be une grand-mère, des grand-mères, and then des grand-mères, okay? So, phonetically, the same form, but you've got to keep in mind that, you know, this is how it should be written correctly. And in that case, keep in mind that the two options are correct, okay? So that's the first part. And it's also possible to see composed words or nouns with first the adjective grand, but at the feminine form, like here, with grande, okay? And then duchesse. And in that case, well, not really difficult because you just, you know, do what we've been doing so far. So you just put S at the end of the first part and S at the end of the second part, okay? And you will get une grande duchesse, plural, des grandes duchesses. It's le pluriel des noms composés, okay? And we'll see actually three different type of noms composés in this video, okay? So we'll start with the first one. And the first one, actually it will be un nom composé. So the first part will be un nom, then the second part will be une préposition, and the last part will be un complément. Okay, so we'll, don't worry, we'll see an example. And in that case, well, in like 90% of the cases, the rule will be that it will be only le premier nom that will take the mark of the plural. Okay, so we'll see just one example. Un arc-en-ciel. Okay, so it's actually quite interesting. So the meaning is here, rainbow, and if you have a look, so you've got first arc, and then you've got the préposition, and after that you've got le complément ciel, okay? And so if we respect the rule that we saw previously, it's only the first part here, so le nom arc, that will take the mark of the plural, and then it will be S, okay? So you will have un arc-en-ciel, and then the plural form, des arc-en-ciel. Okay, you can see that as usual, we don't really pronounce this final S, so phonetically it's almost the same, but then we've got this liaison between the two, des arc-en-ciel. Okay, second situation, un nom formé d'une préposition or un préfixe et d'un nom. Okay, and so in that case, le nom prend la marque du pluriel. Okay, so we'll see an example, and it's a good example and quite useful here. Une demi-heure. Okay, so demi is half, and then heure, hour. Okay, so in that case, you get this demi first, and then you get this heure. Okay, and so if we respect the rule that we saw, it will be only le nom, like here, so heure, that will take here the plural. So you will have to put the S at the end of heure, and you don't touch this prefix demi in that case, okay? Des demi-heures. une demi-heure des demi-heures. OK? And last but not least, un nom formé d'une phrase, locution adverbiale, de verbe ou d'infinitif. OK? And in that case, the good thing is that you don't need to touch the word at all. Okay, so it will stay the same whether it's at the singular form or at the plural. And then just wanted to give you this beautiful one. It's one of my favorite. Un je ne sais quoi. Okay, well, it's quite used in English as well, but then I just wanted to give you maybe a more clear translation. Okay, so un je ne sais quoi, and then if we respect the rule, then des je ne sais quoi. So you don't touch at all the word, you just put it like that, no S, okay, and then phonetically, of course, it's the same pronunciation, okay. Un je ne sais quoi, des je ne sais quoi.